Wonderful. And okay. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the March CMT Education Series. The CMTA hosts these meetings every month to share CMT education with you. I'm Laurel Richardson, the Director of Community Outreach, and we are thrilled to have you with us today. I am going to turn it over to...
Lockdowns are creating huge economic losses.
So let's not... sorry, everyone. If everyone could stay muted, because there's a lot of background noise, and we want to be able to hear Amy and Dr. Zuckner speaking. Thank you so much for that. So I'm going to turn it over to Amy Gray, our CEO of the CMTA. Thanks, Amy.
Thank you, Laurel. I'd like to welcome everyone and thank you for joining us today to learn more about the Distant Cousin Project and get involved in this research study. I'm very proud to share with you that the CMTA is the leading philanthropic funder of CMT research worldwide, and our mission is to help bring treatments to patients. A really important part of our research strategy is to fund work on identifying genes that cause CMT, and we've been very fortunate to work with very closely with a CMT patient and donor who is a huge advocate of CMT research, and it's through his generosity and a donation that has been made that has enabled us to fund work in Dr. Zuckner's lab. So we have the pleasure to have Dr. Zuckner here today to speak more about the work he's doing to identify these culprit genes that cause CMT and how you and your family can get involved in this research study, the Distant Cousin Project. Dr. Zuckner is an incredible CMT researcher, scientist, a member of our advisory board. I'll let him introduce himself when he gives a short presentation here in a minute. He does have a short presentation to share with us today to give a little background on the work that's being done to identify these culprit genes. We will then go into a very short prepared question and answer. And then at the end, we'll open it up to you to ask questions. We want to leave time at the end for you to ask the questions that are burning and on your mind. So with that, Dr. Zuckner, we'll turn it over to you to start the presentation.
Yes. Okay. Good day to everyone. It feels a little weird with my headset, but you can hear me okay?
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, good. So yes, it's great to be here. Thanks for joining. I'm very impressed. So much interest here. I will, as Amy already said, I will explain a little bit what we do in my research team here. And why it is important. We think it's important for advancing the medicine really around CMT. And in fact, I think we live in very exciting times in this regard. So things are really moving, and so there's a lot of hope. So I'm gonna share my screen. And when I'm done, this is not gonna be very long, maybe 15 minutes at most. We will have plenty of time to discuss things. You may have questions, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Okay. Can you see these slides?
Yes.
Great. Okay. So what we do, I'm a professor for human genetics and neurology. So my main interest naturally is to find genes and mutations in patients like yourself and in your family. So in fact, a lot of patients do not receive today. They don't know what exactly their CMT gene is. And I will tell you why this is actually very important to know your gene. So as I said, I'm a professor at the University of Miami. We also, a few years ago, started a foundation that is sort of dedicated to support the genetic work we do, the genetic research. Okay, so now this confusing slide here basically shows you all these different genes that we know today for CMT. So gene names have these weird abbreviations like LITAF or EGR2, okay? These are all different genes. What does it actually mean? 30 years ago, there's actually one CMT gene. It's called PMP22. So at the time, doctors thought that there might be one or two, maybe five CMT genes, and this will explain most patients that we see. But it has turned out differently. Each gene explains certainly the number of patients and their families, but together, all these many different genes explain maybe 50%, 60% of patients genetically. That leaves roughly 50% of patients that do not have an answer today. And that's kind of the key work we are doing here to close what we sometimes call the diagnostic gap, so you don't get a diagnosis in many cases. And to make this possible, you need resources and structures. So one very important structure is the inherited neuropathy consortium. And you see here some of the key members. And I think some of you know these doctors here. And what they do is they, of course, give you an expert diagnosis. Sometimes they can help you understand how this disease develops in the future. And they can order genetic tests. And if those tests do not come back with an answer, then the INC, I'm a member of the INC, works with especially with my lab in Miami, to enroll patients like yourself into research projects to find these genes, okay? Because the clinical side of medicine doesn't really do research. It's all about the known diagnostics. And the other sort of complementary resource we have developed is called the Genesis database. And essentially, to do cutting edge genetic research today, a lot of it is about convincing patients to join and then to study their genes, right? If you study a single person with CMT, it's very hard to identify the underlying gene. And I will tell you why that is in a minute. So we spend a lot of effort to sort of aggregate data, to bring data sets, genome sequencing data sets together from CMT patients. So today we have over 2,000 such genomic data sets in one place in this database. It's very important to also have it in one place. It doesn't have to be the only place, but when you have it all in one place, you can do certain analysis, and basically it comes down to comparing these 2,000 data sets in different ways, comparing them, and that often gives you the key idea and signal for a new discovery. Okay. You also see here there are many more of these data sets in the Genesis database. Those are mostly from diseases that we consider related to CMT. And that can also help comparing CMT patients to patients that do not have CMT, but they have related disorders, such as spastic paraplegias, ataxias, and so on. And we're very happy that we're getting support from the CMTA for a number of years now, because this kind of work, as you can imagine, is actually quite expensive. The data need to be stored, they need to be analyzed, archived, and so on and so forth. And as you can see, it's very international. Also important to compare data sets from different countries, from different ancestries, different kind of people. And the data are being shared amongst different researchers in these countries. So because it's not like we in Miami know everything best. It's often that other people have the right ideas and then we work together. And behind this, of course, is a quite complicated infrastructure and technical environment that we need to maintain. So here's an example. This is a relatively new CMT gene. It's called ATP1A1. And when we published this and discovered this, you can see it was an international discovery. There were physicians and scientists involved from Australia, from Czech Republic, from South Korea even. And altogether, we made it possible. So that's the power of bringing data to one place. It's very important. And just one other slide in this direction. Over the years, there has been some serious science coming out of these efforts. So Nature Genetics, you may have heard of this journal, Nature. It's quite a prestigious journal. And we consider Nature Genetics sort of the top journal in our field. And just in the last 3 years, we had two cover stories. So where the editors decided to put the CMT story on the cover of the Nature Genetics journal. So just publishing them once in your career is an honor. And we have done this in 3 years on the cover. So CMT research is very much alive and successful. And in particular, we will possibly talk about this discovery a little bit more later, because we think that this could in fact become the first treatable form of CMT. We published this about 2 years ago in 2020, and the clinical trials for this type of CMT are going to start this year. In fact, probably the next quarter, the clinical trials will begin. And it is a recessive form of CMT. Okay, so what is the distant cousin project? So one way to think about this is, I mentioned how if we have the entire genome sequence, so we know the code in a person, in a single human genome, and I mentioned that this is difficult to work out the underlying mutation. And why is this difficult? Because in a typical genome, like my own, you would find about 4 million places where my genome is different from what is considered the reference or the normative genome. So I care about 4 million changes. And the idea is that if somebody has CMT, then there is one of these 4 million is in a critical place that changes things. So you actually have CMT. So sort of sifting through 4 million variants, even with the great help of computers, is a daunting task. And in fact, what often happens is that we might even see the correct variant there, the mutation, but we don't recognize it. We kind of don't see the trees for the forest. So that's really what it's the basis of this, that each of us carries so many different variants. And that makes each of us, of course, also a very unique being. Okay, so now each of us here is of course part of a family. And some of us say, you know, there's this notion that sometimes you meet somebody and you talk and then you realize, gosh, you have such a large family, right? The truth is each of us have a very large family. It's just that some people or some families are very good at keeping track of their history of their family and stay in connection or keeping records. So then of course, they have a large family that is being sort of recognized and known about, but each of us has a very large family, obviously. We come from somewhere. And so when you look at this sort of a drawing, this might be you, parents or children, and then of course grandparents. So that's kind of a more immediate family, but then it goes on to great-grandparents, grand aunts, and then cousins, of course, first cousins. Many of us have cousins. But then there are also second cousins. And then if you really keep track of a family, you may even have second cousins, okay? Or second cousins once removed. the idea is simply that all these people are connected. They are connected through their ancestry. Okay. So now imagine this red circle here would be you, and you have CMT. And since you are, and the CMT is caused by a specific change in your genome, a mutation. And it is absolutely conceivable that your parents also had this, and it came from the grandparents, and this came from the great-great-grandparents, and all the way over here to the third cousin, who also might have CMT. If by chance this person carries the same variant that you carry, the same mutation, then that person very likely also have CMT. So now you both would have CMT because you share through your great-great-grandparents, you share this unfortunate mutation, okay? But because there's so many generations in between, a lot of the other variation you carry in your genome is not shared, right? It's different. So the further out you go, the less you share with a distant relative. That I think makes intuitive sense. And we can use this phenomenon, this very obvious phenomenon, to find CMT genes. So you, in your genome, we might find 100 variants where one of them might be the correct mutation, but it's so hard to decide which one it is. Actually, your sibling, if you have one, shares by chance 50 of these genes with you, okay? But the further we go out, as I said, the less is shared. If you still share the one crucial CMT change, it's actually very feasible for us to identify it. If we would have the genome of your third cousin and your own genome and we compare them, there is very little shared. And as long as you both have CMT, there's a great chance that we actually can spot the correct mutation and make a diagnosis. And this is really what the Distant Cousin Project is about. To encourage you, if you like, to explore your family history and see if you can find a distant relative who also has CMT. And you might be surprised because when I think about my own family, I probably wouldn't even realize. And if you could convince this distant relative to also participate in the study, the funding we have available would allow us to create a genome sequence from you and the distant relative. And then we would compare your genomes and possibly we would be able to spot the underlying gene. Okay, there was a lot of words, but here's an example, a recent example. This large family here, two of my research assistants went to Wisconsin recently, and they had contacted a family that we thought is fairly small, but then the family has really went out and they invited all these relatives to a small village with a town hall, and we were able to do a neurological exam, a medical exam, and take a blood sample from 29 individuals from this one family. And by talking to all of them, we were able to reconstruct all the relationships, okay? And now here's this picture. You can imagine if this person over here and this person over here, it turned out they share the exact same change mutation in this gene, IDPR3. And that allowed us to really absolute certainty determined that this is the gene that this family carries. And I may say that the index patient of this family has been very active and has been fundraising for 20 years. And she just learned about this diagnosis last week from us because this is how new this data is. And it just illustrates that this is indeed possible. Okay, this would be a great example for a distant cousin situation. And this gene is a new gene now. And actually, this has been selected, this finding, to be presented at the national, at the International Peripheral Nerve Society meeting, which will happen in May in Miami. Okay, so just to finish up, so my last slide. Again, if you're interested in this very specific project, these are sort of the very simple qualifications. You would have to be a patient, a person with CMT, and in the perfect world already have a negative genetic test. So basically you're one of those patients who have done what they can, but the commercial genetic tests are negative. And then you must identify a distant relative who also has the symptoms and is willing to participate, okay? If this is the case, you may contact us, and we will then reach out. We will obtain a research consent, document your willingness to participate. And then we would create two genome sequences. This is the latest technology, whole genome sequences. This goes way beyond what commercial labs offer. And we would create these data sets free of charge and then compare these data sets, hoping that we can spot the mutation in your family, okay? And to facilitate this, here's an email you can use, and also Amy, I know she had some communication around it. I'm sure you'll find a way to contact us. The only downside right now is in Miami, we're a little bit short-staffed. So in case you emailed us, or maybe you have already emailed us in the last 2 weeks or 3 weeks, my coordinator, Lisa, many of you may know Lisa, she actually is on medical leave for the last 6 weeks. So this has been quite a bit of a problem for us, but we will catch up. So this is not a quick project. This is very involved, and we want to continue this if you're interested to participate. And I think I'll leave it at this, and then we can have a discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Zechner. Just a couple follow-up questions from the CMTA, and then we'll open it up to the rest of the participants. I know this is always a difficult question to answer, but it's one we, you know, hear a lot from the community. So we'll start with this one. How long might this study last, and when might participants get a result?
Right. So the study should last potentially a long time, right? I do this research for over 20 years. Studying large families has always been a very important element. We have funding from this anonymous donor to study 10 families. So maybe creating a little competition here, the first 10 families that qualify will definitely be sequenced. But if this is very successful, I'm sure we can find additional funding to continue this effort. And results, these things sometimes can take time. So from enrollment to a complete analysis, this is easily 3 to 6 months. And sometimes that is just the first wave of analysis. You know, as I pointed out in this example, in this family, the index patient really waited for almost 20 years. Not like we had this for 20 years, but we had her data for several years, and we did not spot it until we realized how large the family is. So it can sometimes take years, you know, but if it was easy, we wouldn't sit here and discuss it. So.
Thank you. Thank you for answering that. And maybe just taking a couple steps back, the first few slides you spoke about the concerted effort to identify some of these unknown genes. Can you speak to, from a drug and therapy development standpoint, why that is so critical?
Yeah. So as you probably know, there is not really a therapy available today for CMT that would slow or stop or even reverse symptoms, Okay, that's where we are. It's not because of lack of trying. Especially CMTA has been instrumental to engage industry, new ideas, but also academic researchers to create therapies. It just turned out it's very difficult because also it has to be safe, right? In a mouse, sometimes we can cure a mouse, but it's just not safe for humans. So there is only in the last, I would say maybe 3 to 5 years that we see a complete revolution in medicine coming slowly, slowly. And that is genetic therapy. So genetic therapy now, what is special about it is instead of what you do is you treat your mutation. So you, and when you can treat the mutation on the DNA level, okay, you treat the disease at its root. So you remove the root cause. And it has taken a long time for medicine to come to a point where this is considered a relatively safe treatment. Okay, the first genetic treatment on the market, the first genetic drug, was only approved 4 years ago or so for a type of blindness, a rare form of blindness. And these children, they were blind. And when they got this treatment, they started seeing 20/20 again. That's the kind of super, super powerful therapy. But big concerns, if you mess with your DNA, it better be very safe, right? So, but there is now, in fact, a large number of trials coming along, especially for genetic therapies. Now, to do this, besides the safety and the technical difficulties, what is very important is to understand these genetic therapies are very personal. You have to know with absolute certainty that a person has the disease because of a very specific mutation. If you don't know your gene, or if you don't know your mutation, you cannot receive a genetic therapy. And that is becoming a big deal, actually. As these therapies are becoming available over the next, 5 to 10 years for sure, you will only be able to take these drugs when you know your gene. Right, so that's what is sometimes called personalized medicine. That's in the direction it goes in. It would be great to have a kind of an aspirin type medicine for CMT, right? You take it and you get better, and everybody takes the aspirin who needs it. But the hope for an aspirin type medicine for CMT is kind of low. There are attempts to do that, absolutely. But so far, none has really worked out. So,
I was just going to add that there's been a very well-publicized success story recently that you and your team were a huge part of. Perhaps you can share a little bit about that discovery and how that is now applicable to developing a therapy for a newly discovered form of CMT.
Yeah. So, Amy's referring to this discovery of the SORD gene, S-O-R-D. And surprisingly, when we found it, it became clear that this new gene for CMT probably represents the most important recessive type of CMT. We can estimate that there are some 3,000 individuals in the United States alone that have this type of CMT. And when we discovered it, something was there, a situation that is rare, but can happen, because what the gene is, it's an enzyme, and where it is, and what is known about it, we pretty much immediately had an idea how to treat it. And in fact, there are drugs that have been used for other types of diseases, developed for other diseases, and we quite certain that these drugs will help CMT patients. And to make the point, we have already shown in animal models that this is the case. So you can cure fruit flies that don't laugh, but fruit flies also have legs, and they don't walk right when they have this gene. But when you treat them, they can walk again. We also showed in principle that you can cure cells that CMT patients have donated to us. We can cure these cells in vitro. And because the drugs are already there and being tested and they are safe, it has enabled a collaboration with a pharma company, name is Applied Therapeutics, and they have acted super quickly and they are ready to go. In fact, last summer, they did a very limited trial already on 10 patients. It was a six-week trial to just, again, show the safety. And a regular trial will actually start this April or May. It will begin. And I'm super optimistic because in this case, Amy, we really understand. Mm-hmm. We really understand this gene. And if this works, that would be phenomenal.
I think it's incredibly exciting news. Even as a 1A patient, Dr. Zuckner, it feels like such great hope for the rest of us, knowing how translational research and information can be. So congratulations to you and your team. It's an incredibly exciting time, as you said, really truly unprecedented. When it comes to research of genetic diseases. So let's open it up for questions. And I think the most systematic way to do this is you can put your question in chat or you can raise your Zoom hand if you would like to do that. And we'll just go from there. So I see that one question has come into the chat. So I'm just going to dive in and read this from Jan. Or Jan, if you want to unmute and ask your question, you're welcome to do so. That might be easier.
Okay. So can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Sorry, I have a sore throat today, so I didn't know if you could hear me. So I have the Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease 2A2A. So I have it from the recessive and the dominant gene. I don't understand what it means to have a negative, what it means to have a negative basic gene test.
Yeah. So when you do a genetic test, so when you go to your doctor first, right? And he's a neurologist or she's a neurologist. What they will examine you, right? And they might torture you with needles. Some of you might have done that. And what they're able to tell you is, number one, you have CMT. CMT is really a broad umbrella term, okay? It's like saying you have a cold. You have a cold. You have CMT. It's a broad term. And then they can also say things like, your CMT type, your subtype, you're in a subgroup, that is, for instance, CMT1 or CMT2, all right? But that's pretty much all the doctor can tell you in their office. What they then often do, and hopefully always do, is they order a genetic test. And that genetic test covers typically now all the known CMT genes. There are about 100 known CMT genes. So they will test every single gene if there is something wrong in one of these genes. And in many cases, they can find, in fact, there's something wrong in the CMT2A gene, okay? Or there's something wrong in the CMT1A gene, okay? So it's a terrible classification because we have all these numbers. But each number, 2A, 1A, 1B, they're all subtypes. They're all different subtypes. They all CMT. The patients look often similar, but the root cause, the mutation, is in a different gene. Okay. So, in fact, Jan, you're kind of lucky in a way because you got your diagnosis down to the genetic level. but at least 50% of CMT patients, they don't get that. The test, the expensive test that's being performed, comes back and they say there is everything is fine in the known CMT genes, right?
So would I not qualify then?
Correct. This study is really for patients that do not know what type they have.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you, Dan. Penny Raymond asks, is your ITPR3 finding yet published?
No, this is brand new. So we always are very open from the get-go. We hope to publish this later this year. To be completely fair, there has been one or two reports that suggested this gene in the past, but it's not a recognized CMT gene as of today. And this study we have now with seven families will absolutely establish this in the scientific community. And then down the road, commercial tests will also test for this gene.
Very exciting. And Marcia says, I live in Maine. There's a lack of CMT doctors who know about this disease. I have CMT for sure, but can't find out my type. There's so many blood tests for it. I don't know which one to choose. And I would encourage you, Marcia, to just before Dr. Zuckner answers, if you are able to get to a center of excellence, you have incredible choices in, you know, Boston, Philadelphia, Rochester, and those CMT experts would probably have to help you so you don't have to figure out as a patient which one to order.
That's right.
Marshall, I will also put my email in the chat so you can reach out to me and I can help you if you're able to travel, help you share some more information and resources with you. John asks, if the treatment is approved for SORD mutation, what would the time frame be for that? 5 years, 10 years?
So, I mean, again, this is an exceptional kind of once in a lifetime situation. The trial is scheduled to start now, basically, as I said. To my knowledge, the trial would last anywhere between 1 and 3 years, okay? Maybe even longer. The thing is with these trials is basically, you have a group of patients that you treat with the drug or with a placebo, right? It's a pill that looks like the drug, but it's not the drug. And so these volunteer participants of this trial, they don't know, right? So that's kind of 50-50 really. And then doctors will follow these participants and over time, keep testing them again, maybe every 6 months, every 3 months, something like this. And then what they look for is, of course, do the participants who actually get the real drug, are they getting better or they have just a better symptoms than the ones who don't get the real drug. Since CMT, sometimes it can go pretty quickly, but many times it's kind of chronic, right? It might even stay the same over a number of years. It can take a while to start seeing that difference. And the trial will go until this difference becomes apparent, or unfortunately, if the company, you know, for other reasons decides to say, okay, 1 year, 2 years, we can't do any more, then the trial stops. And in the worst case, there is no difference. And then it's negative. So, but let's stay positive. realistically speaking, I would expect from what I have seen and know, there is a chance that after about 2 years, the data will support that this drug is actually helpful. And when this happens, it can go pretty quickly, actually. It can be within another 6 months or so that there's some kind of approval or preliminary approval available. So I would say realistically, anywhere between 1 and 2.5 years, okay? There might be an approval of some sort that everybody can join and take the drug.
Excellent. Thank you. The next question comes from Paul, and he asks, for those who are not fortunate enough to find a distant relative with CMT, is there hope that new DNA analysis technology or other technology, AI, for example, that will make getting a complete genome sequencing more accessible? It seems that for many people, we will not have access to labs such as yours that have the most complete CMT data in their testing capacity. That is, many of us with undiagnosed CMT may just watch and wait for years, wondering if we might have a form that has already been, that has been discovered already, but we will never know it.
Right. Now, excellent comment. You know, the distant cousin project is a special idea. And I, what I personally like is, theoretically, it could encourage some of you to, you know, you sometimes may think, what can I do? What can I, can, is there something I can do? And actually, yes, you can do something. You could do some family history research in your own family. So there is something you could do. And I think that might be for some of you a good thing. That does not mean by any means that those who just don't have relatives or the only one in the family of CMT, that there is no way forward. Of course, we study CMT on all levels. Only that particular study is focusing on this approach. So Paul, you know, you you correct that DNA analysis technology is improving all the time. It's improving all the time. So it will take many more years, but I mean, it's unbelievable how good it has become already.
It's amazing. Patty is asking if anyone else has CMT too. Patty, I've shared my email address for anyone who has questions or is looking for resources or trying to connect with others. So I would encourage you to reach out to me and I'll try to help connect you with others in Pittsburgh. Next question from Catherine. With all the newly discovered types of CMT found through this study be added to the standard panel, how often would you suggest unknown type patients seek retesting because of the updated panels? Or will the Center of Excellence clinics keep their sample on file and retest automatically? That is a great question.
Yeah. The second part, I don't think that's just the way medicine works in our country. I don't think they would automatically just sort of retest in a clinical fashion. It's a bit hard to say how often it is useful to retest commercially because it still takes a couple of years typically. If my research lab publishes something like the IDPR3 gene, it probably take a year or two until it shows up on panels, okay? Every year, it's unbelievable, but in the CMT field, there's probably every year there is a handful of new genes that are being published. So if you test every 4 years, you know, there might be 10 or so new genes on the panel. It might be worth it. It's a bit hard to say. I would say I can't really give a recommendation, but it's not like every year there's exciting new stuff on these panels and they should retest. It takes a little longer.
Gotcha. Great. Next question from Kenny. Have you seen any indication of AMPD1 linkage to neuropathy or AMPD1 associated myopathy also causing neuropathy?
I'm not familiar with AMPD1. Not to my knowledge. Okay.
Gotcha. Margaret, I see your hand up if you want to unmute and ask your question.
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you explain briefly what vehicle you anticipate using to deliver the gene, the correct gene, to a patient with CMT2 in order to get the gene to the axon?
Right. Margaret, it's a very advanced question. Thank you. Yeah. So, but a very good question. Basically, to bring it down a little bit, Margaret is asking, if you want to perform genetic therapy, and specifically something like, you may have heard CRISPR, okay?
Uh-huh.
Or gene replacement. So in recessive diseases, often the gene is not there anymore, so you can replace it with a correct copy. How do you bring that corrected copy into the nerves, right? How do you do that? And one way scientists do this is they put it in a sort of a, like an envelope, okay? Like basically a mailing envelope type thing. And what they use is, actually they use a virus. So viruses have these, and you know, we all now, unfortunately, familiar with COVID virus, and you see all these pictures of these round spiky things that support to what the COVID looks like. So there are viruses that are completely harmless, and you can actually take out everything that's inside and put the correct gene in, but keep the envelope. That's what scientists do. And these viruses, the outside, the envelope is really good at infecting cells, as happens in COVID, right? COVID is good at infecting certain cells in our lungs and so on, and that cause symptoms. There are other viruses that are good at infecting nerves, all right? So to be very technical, Margaret, there's now good data that something called the AAV9 type virus could be quite useful for CMT. But to be honest, this is developing all the time.
Okay.
And what in the end it will be, it will be something that works. That's the key thing.
So this would be injected into the intrathecal space? Is that what you're thinking?
So yeah. Also there, things develop all the time. Right now, there are in fact genetic gene replacement therapies on the market for some extremely severe diseases that are kind of related to CMT. They're called spinal muscular atrophy.
Okay.
These children, they inject it intrathecally. So that's a one-time injection in your back, okay? And that might very well be a way to do it for CMT if it's available. But to be honest, also there are a lot of developments. And of course, the ultimate goal is to not, you know, poke your back, but maybe do a regular infusion, like a regular infusion into your system. And I think eventually we'll probably get to that place, but we don't know yet.
Okay. Can I ask one more question, or am I?
Sure. Go ahead, Margaret.
Okay. Unrelated. Can you, you know, you're trying to find genes that cause neuropathy, CMT, in idiopathic patients. Is there any utility in GEDmatch? Can you use your suspected genes and run them through GEDmatch and possibly send a message to people where there's a match and say, hey, do you have neuropathy? Or are there legal problems?
Yeah. So I'm not so familiar with GEDmatch, but I think it's that matching system that looks for ancestry matching, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a very good question. I guess let me answer this in two ways. First of all, I showed you what we do with the Genesis database, and we share in an anonymous fashion with bona fide scientists these data so that we can get input and have more people participate in that analysis. And we call this actually matchmaking, genetic matchmaking. So say a scientist in Australia has a new CMT gene, but it's not certain. They reach out to us and say, can you look in the Genesis database? Do you see more cases in this gene? And I might say, oh yeah, we have two cases. I never realized they have this gene. So this could be all the same, right? So this kind of matching and sharing is happening amongst the community. And that's actually a key element for the successes. And I showed the slides. Now, what you say is quite interesting in the terms of the distant cousin project, right? So some of you might have done 23andMe or similar ancestry services. Some of them actually offer you an option that they will tell you, we found distant relatives of yours in our database. And then they even offer, do you want to connect with them? Okay, so you may have seen this, heard about it. There are actually many people who have rediscovered parts of their family through these ancestry services, all right? So there are all kinds of very moving stories out there. It is technically possible to think that if you have CMT and you do one of these services, and GEDmatch is, I think, it's kind of an umbrella that covers many of them.
Yes.
And that's your personal choice, right? If you do that, and you might discover family members that you didn't even know were out there. And if you're willing to connect with them, you might discover that some of them have CMT. If that's the case, this would be extremely powerful, because if then these newly discovered family members and yourself would be willing to do the research, we could then absolutely pick you up at this point in time and, you know, consent you, do your comparison analysis. But what we cannot do is, I don't think we're allowed to, Margaret, say, take your genome, create your genome, and put it into GEDmatch. We're not allowed. This is your genome. This is very private. But you could do it. You could do it.
Okay. Very interesting. Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Couple more quick questions, and as we near the hour, Kelly says, I know many widely available genetic testing. She's basically asking, is the saliva test genetic testing as reliable as, say, the blood genetic test?
It is as reliable. And we have even done saliva collections for genome tests. It works. It's completely reliable. We still do prefer blood, but that's a minor difference there. More for technical purposes, it's somewhat easier. But saliva is absolutely workable, yes.
Okay, great. Marcia asked, I know we have recessive and dominant genes. How does this relate to CMT disease?
So, yes, in genetics, there are kind of several different ways how you can inherit from your parents a genetic disorder. One type is the most common type. It's called dominant. That means typically one of your parents also has the same disorder, and you receive whatever the mutation is in that parent, you receive that, and then you also will develop the genetic disorder. Another type is the so-called recessive type. In this case, both your parents carry a mutation, but they are healthy because the mutation is kind of a minor, okay? Think of it like a minor effect. So the parents are healthy, but they carry that thing, often unknown to them. And then you or the patient would actually inherit from each parent that faulty element, and then two minors make one major, and then you get the disease. That's kind of the recessive.
Excellent. Thank you. I know there are a few different hereditary patterns, and we also have some wonderful webinars on our website that explain the difference between dominant and recessive and what those inheritance patterns look like.
And I want to point out, Laura, because this is all sounds so negative. All of us, we have inherited a lot of things from our parents. Most of them are pretty good, so okay.
Right. We can focus on the good, the positive. Yeah. Okay, wonderful. Well, we are nearing the hour. I want to, Amy, were you able to come back on? I think Amy was having computer problems. And
thank you, Dr. Zechner, for an incredible, informative meeting today. And thank you all for joining us.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for sharing your time and talents with us. As always, Dr. Zechner, you're very generous with your time and a wonderful partner to the CMTA. Many exciting things going on, so we'll be sure to keep up to date with you. And also, everyone, we have recorded this session, so if you weren't able to attend the whole time, in the next week, we will have it up on our website, but I'll also email it out to you. You should all have my email address, but I also put it in the chat for any follow-up questions that we didn't get to during this hour. Thanks, everyone. And thank you, Dr. Zechner, for being with us. It was a great presentation. Thanks, Amy.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.